Hare Krishna. Question: has ISKCON replaced the scriptural worship of Ganesh in temples with the non-scriptural worship of Prabhupada in its temples? In all temples, even Krishna temples in Maharashtra, say, or in other parts of India, there is the Ganesh worship at the entrance. Ganesh is worshipped at the entrance, but ISKCON temples don't have that. Instead, they have the deity of Prabhupada, isn't it? Non-scriptural and bona fide? Answer: no, the two are not that one is a replacement for the other. The two are two entirely different things. The first is that Lord Ganesh is Vinayak, Vighna Nashak. He is a person who destroys obstacles, and that's why invoking him at the start of any auspicious activity is a standard practice in the Vedic literature and is standard Hindu practice today also. So that's why the idea of having Ganesh is that he is a particular devata in charge of a particular department that is removing obstacles at the start of things, and that's why he is invoked. So that's one particular aspect. The worship of this guru is an entirely different thing. Now the Bhagavatam itself says that Acharya Mam Vijaniyam Na Avmanyet Karhichit, that Acharya know him to be as good as me and do not disrespect him. Sarva Deva Mayo Guru, that all the devatas are present in the guru. So if the guru is as good as Krishna, if the guru is the personification of all the devatas, then when Krishna is worshipped and devatas are worshipped, then should the guru not be worshipped? So the tradition of worshipping the guru is something which is not at all unprecedented or something new. It is a very time-honored tradition. Now specifically, if we see even in the Mahabharata Ramayana, when the great sages appear, then they are worshipped. So when Krishna comes as the Shanti Dut to meet the Pandavas, to meet the Kauravas, and then he is offered a royal seat, but when he says that there are Narada, Parshuram, Kanva, other great rishis are there. So when he says, how can we sit without offering them seats and worship first? How can I accept worship before that? So he asks that they be worshipped, and then after that he accepts worship and then he sits. So now the fact that the great sages who are like spiritual teachers, now here we see for the Kauravas, neither Narada nor Parashuram nor Kanva were directly their spiritual master, and yet they were worshipped. So what to speak of not worshipping one's spiritual master? Now we may have say that is just when they are coming as guests we are worshipping. We are not installing a deity of them and worshipping. That's true, but we see there are precedents for that also. Within the history of the Sanatana Dharma in India, we see that there have been certain spiritual teachers who have been extremely powerful, and they have started disciplic lines. They have systematized ancient traditions, and their contribution is so remarkable that they hold a distinct place, not just in the, at large in the broad religious history of India, and definitely in the history of that tradition. So for example, Ramacharya and the Sri Sampradaya, or Madhvacharya and the Madhva Sampradaya. And for these acharyas, deities are made and they are worshipped. So now, that again, the worship of a great saint when he is not present in the form of a deity of that saint is also not unprecedented. It is done. It is of course done with Mayavadi, with impersonalist understandings in many impersonalist traditions. But even within Vaishnava traditions, the worship of the guru is done. And we see that it was not just Srila Prabhupada who did this in the Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition. Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur also, he did it. Now, before that, Gaudiya Vaishnavism was not exactly so structured. And there was not one acharya who was preaching extremely widely and doing a lot of and having a lot of disciples and followers. So that sort of institution was not there, and so institutionalized systems of worship were also not required. So Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur reinforce the scriptural principle that we approach Krishna through the Guru. And that means we worship the Guru and then we worship Krishna. So that's how it is in the Gaudiya tradition, and it has a precedence in the Vedic tradition also, in this tradition of Sanatana Dharma at large. So Prabhupada has a unique position in that sense that he is the person who spread Krishna consciousness far and wide. And even from an objective perspective, even if one doesn't accept the specific principles and practices of Krishna consciousness, still the achievement that Srila Prabhupada did in sharing Krishna consciousness all over the world is stupendous. So he is worshipped as the founder Acharya of ISKCON, and that's why there is his worship also. So the two are not related, that it is not that Prabhupada is in any way usurping the position of Ganesh. Prabhupada is worshipped because he is the Acharya and the founder Acharya of this particular organization. And worship of the founder Acharyas has precedence in the broad tradition of Sanatana Dharma. Now, regarding why Ganesh is not worshipped in ISKCON temples, no, that is based on Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita, Krishna does indicate that those who worship the devatas are kamaistaiste hrita jnanaha. They are less intelligent. And he also says that alpamedhasaha, those who worship, this is 7.1 to 7.20 and then it is 7.23. Those who worship the devatas are less intelligent, alpamedhasaha. So, and then Krishna also says in 9.23-24 that those who worship the devatas are also worshipping me, but because they don't know me, ye pena devata bhakta jante shuddhayanvita tep mameva kaunte jante avidipurvakam, they're worshipping me but they're doing it in a non-bona fide way, and that's why that's not recommended. So Krishna does say that if you look at overall the Bhagavad Gita's tenor, that there is no need to worship the devatas. And that means, yes, there is a tradition which comes in the scripture only of worshipping the devatas, but there are multiple levels in the scriptures. So for people who have many material desires, they are recommended to worship the devatas. But for those who are aspiring for pure devotion, for them it is recommended no need to worship the devatas. They can focus on the worship of Krishna itself. So I have given this example repeatedly that, say, a student is at 40%, a father has two sons, one gets 40% marks and barely passes, the other gets 80% marks. Now today if both get 60%, then the person who has got 40% and come to 60%, who regularly gets 40% and has come to 60%, for him the father will say, shabash, very well done. And for the person who has come down from 80% to 60%, the same father will say, badmash, what have you done? Why the difference? Because their levels are different. So for those who are materialistic and godless, for them the worship of demigods is recommended. And for those who are capable of practicing pure devotion, for them worship of demigod worship is discouraged. So yes, there are many parts of the Vedic literature in which the worship of Ganesh is recommended. But then the Vedaischa Sarvairahame Vedyo Vedanta Krit Veda Videvachaham, that it is Krishna who is the source of the Vedas, and that same Krishna is telling us, Mam Ekam Sharanam Raja, worship me alone. So therefore we follow scripture when we don't worship Ganesh, but it's not that absolute principle that Ganesh cannot be worshipped. If there is some social convention which is widely followed, and if Ganesh is being worshipped and devotees in their individual houses, because it's a social convention they want to have Ganesh, they can in special situations, in consultation with their local spiritual guides, have a small Ganesh deity and worship him with the verses like Yat Pada Pankaj, Yat Pada Pallav Yugam Vinidhaya Kumbha, where the Brahma Samhita verse which describes Ganesh's relationship with the Supreme Lord, and then worship him as a devotee of the Supreme Lord. That in the special conventions, special situations, in deference to social conventions, can be done. Thank you. Hare Krishna.